Hello, this is Anthony Effinger. I am your host on the Think Neuro podcast from Pacific Neuroscience Institute. Today, I am talking with Dr. Sarah McEwen. She's a senior research scientist at PNI's Brain Health Center. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks so much for having me, Anthony. I'm super excited to be here and talk about the clinical trials we're running at the Brain Health Center.
Yeah, now you've got an unusual title at PNI. You're a PhD among mostly MDs. Now, why is that?
Well, I mean, honestly, that's really the draw that brought me to the PNI Institute and, you know, the creation of the Pacific Brain Health Center, which started about 2 years ago. So I was working with currently the director of the Pacific Brain Health Center at UCLA. We were both in the Department of Psychiatry. We were both a little bit fed up with how siloed we were over there. We were trying to do some cool research together. Dr. Merrill was trying to get a cognitive clinic up and running with exercise and more of a precision-based approach. And it was hard to do in a big academic institution. So the ability for Dr. Kelly to draw us over to PNI, where we were able to have a really good evidence-based research institute embedded within a clinical practice, was something that was just a game changer for the both of us. So we were really excited to come over there and work together and really try to do something different where, you know, PhDs are embedded within a clinical practice where we're learning directly from the clinicians what they're seeing every day with the patients. And then we're bringing in the latest breaking science and how we can develop really cool interventions in real time and then deploy those in the clinic. It's a really, really exciting place to be. So I feel very fortunate.
So tell us how you got involved in this kind of research. What was the first time? When did you know you were going to be a brain scientist?
probably when I was a child, actually. And I started exercising and I realized how good it made me feel and how it affected, you know, my mood and, you know, my thinking skills and everything. So I was I was a bit of a strange kid where, you know, most kids wanted to be firefighters or, you know, police officers. Like, I wanted to be a psychologist. Like, I really loved it. You know, I loved, you know, the way that I could, you know, change my mood and my brain functioning based on what I was doing. And I didn't know it at the time, but that was something called neuroplasticity. So when I got into graduate school and started learning about different interventions that could change the brain, exercise was really the one that always stood out to me. So over the last about 15 years, I've been doing clinical research looking at the effects of exercise on brain plasticity and functioning, specifically in cases of schizophrenia, Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, diseases that are, you know, really scary and unfortunately don't really have a cure at this stage. So the effects of exercise, I mean, if you can think of a panacea for the brain, it's really exercise. So I think, as a researcher, it's a fascinating, you know, tool, kind of a Swiss Army knife, if you will, for the brain to study.
It feels to me like in back in the old days, people didn't think about, physical exercise being associated with mental acuity. When did people start to see this connection?
This was probably about actually just like 20 years ago that this really started to come out. So there was some really cool pioneering research that was done at the Salk Institute by Dr. Fred Gage there. And he was the first to study animals exercising and actually open up their brains after they've been exercising for several weeks and find out that actually those exercising animals grew brand new neurons within the hippocampus in the brain, which is our learning and memory center in the brain. So this was the first time they were actually showing in vivo that new neurons were generated because of exercise. And they were comparing those to the brains of animals that hadn't been exercising and didn't have a wheel in their cage. So that was really, really cool research. And that was only in the last 20 years. So this really is a new growing field of research.
So just to clarify, when you say plasticity, you mean growing new brain cells?
I mean, there's many, 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 many kinds of, you know, neuroplasticity, if you will, but looking at the growth of new neurons, which is neurogenesis, but exercise also does something called angiogenesis, which is new blood vessels, synaptogenesis, which is new synapses that are created in the brain. There's such a host and cascade of neurochemical mechanisms that are released through physical activity and exercise you can't just say that it's just one thing. And that's why it's such a panacea, I feel like, because it acts on so many different neurotransmitter systems, hormones in the brain, reducing inflammation, reducing pro-inflammatory cytokines, all these things that we know are implicated in chronic neurodegenerative conditions. So it really is an excellent intervention to act on many, many different neurochemical pathways in the brain.
Is this because we evolved to be like physical creatures and our brains were sort of programmed to behave that way?
Yes. And unfortunately, in today's society, we've been almost reprogrammed to be the other way, sitting here at our computers all day and not activating, our bodies in the way that, hunter-gatherers of past years had done. Where really the idea was that our brains were designed to be exercising and hunting and foraging and, not using our ways to navigate through the forest, So we weren't really relying on all of those tools. So yeah, our brains have definitely adapted. There's an adaptive capacity model that was developed by a researcher that's at USC now, which was basically saying that, it was the role of the brain to be exercising and to be cognitively activated through, thousands and thousands of years of development. And that's, where we are now. But unfortunately, I think the statistic is somewhere around 80% of people aren't even getting the American College of Sports Medicine recommendation for exercise, which is 150 minutes of activity a week, which really isn't that much. 30 minutes, 5 days a week.
Well, yeah. I did a HIIT class today before coming on to talk with you.
Good for you. Thank you.
I did not want to come unprepared and I wanted to be sharp.
Well, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of research to suggest too, that kind of the benefits of exercise are best in the morning. And then also there's kind of this elevation of all those amazing neurochemicals I was talking about that kind of increase about 15 minutes into exercise and then are sustained for about an hour afterwards. So that's kind of where you have the peak of, cognitive boost, if you will.
Oh, so I wasn't crazy to do that.
Not at all. No. It's a type of priming. And we actually have a study at the Brain Health Center where that's exactly what we're looking at, where we're trying to look at, the temporal ordering of exercise and how that affects cognitive functioning. And I honestly think that the best way to do it is to combine them simultaneously. So there's a lot of research looking at cognitive motor training, showing that that's actually like this simultaneous act, dual tasking, if you will, of doing aerobic exercise while doing specific neurocognitive training exercises. And that actually shows a greater boost in cognitive functioning. And the director of the Pacific Brain Health Center, Dr. David Merrill, and I did a study at UCLA where that's exactly what we did. And we actually compared two groups where we had one group that was doing aerobic exercise on a sedentary bike and then memory training. And then the other group was actually doing simultaneous exercise. So instead of having the exercise like you did this morning, and then your cognitive stimulation, our amazing interview, what the simultaneous group was doing, they were actually on the bike doing their cognitive training. And they did that for 4 weeks. And then we compared them on standardized neurocognitive tests after 4 weeks of doing that type of training two times a week for about 60-minute sessions. So really not that much of a dose. And what we found was really striking is the simultaneous exercise group actually significantly improved their memory functioning better than the group that did the exercise and then the cognitive training.
So tell me what the simultaneous people were doing exactly.
They were on a recumbent bike. We were getting their heart rate elevated. So they were right in that sweet spot aerobic zone, which is, I like to call it like the aerobic plasticity zone, which is about 60 to 85% of your maximum heart rate. So you can measure that, with the Apple Watch or a Fitbit. So you can monitor your heart rate. So you get into that aerobic zone. And then we were actually having an instructor give them cognitive training and compensatory memory training exercises. So the cool thing about this kind of training is it's not just trying to get you to do drill and practice like, brain training exercises and those things, but it's actually giving you the new skills and strategies to help your memory, because everybody in this study had a subjectively reported memory problem. So these are people who are already starting to see problems with their, it's not just forgetting your keys or why you went in a room sort of stuff, but like, what are you doing today? Like all pretty significant impairments they're starting to have, So we were really trying to give them new tools and skills so they could really, what they call scaffold their cognitive processes, where they're building upon deficits that they have and creating new compensatory strategies to be able to remember things.
Describe, by compensatory, you mean, tell what that means exactly.
So compensatory strategies are really ways that you can try to circumvent the fact that you can't remember things very well. And usually that's caused by atrophy in the hippocampus, which is the earliest sign of a memory disorder, such as Alzheimer's disease. So people that have deficits in that specific part of the brain, it's really hard for them to remember new information and also store long-term memories. So what we want to basically do is give them new strategies and tools for their toolbox to try to remember things a little bit better. So I think one of the most common deficits people have is remembering, you know, new people when they meet them and remembering their names. So we try to give them strategies to remember, you know, faces and names. And we give them things like find a striking feature on someone's face. So for me, a lot of people notice my eyes and Sarah's blue eyes, and she lives in San Diego. So, you know, blue eyes, ocean, Sarah, San Diego, you know, alliteration, those sorts of things. So I think if you use some just kind of fun, you know, mnemonic sort of strategies and visualization and imagery, it helps to try to circumvent just the rote memorization of just like, how do I remember this person that I've just met now? And I have no way to just, you know, encode that without having this richer compensatory strategy to help me. So things like that are the kind of strategies we would teach them.
When you say that the hippocampus is atrophying, that means that that section of the brain is getting smaller.
Yes, exactly. And the normal trajectory of aging, unfortunately, after the age of 40, our hippocampus starts to atrophy about 1% every year. However, in disorders like schizophrenia, Alzheimer's disease, it's much, much more rapid. So as soon as the illness really, really starts to set in, you're seeing atrophy of 5 to 10 times what you would see in a normal aging. So you see this accelerated aging process happening in neurodegenerative conditions. And what they think is on brain imaging scans, it's actually the neuropil, which is in the center of the neurons. It's mainly where the cell bodies live. And that's what seems to be atrophying. And that's what we're actually able to pick up on magnetic resonance imaging or MRI scans. So a lot of times when patients are presenting in the clinic, we have them go in for an MRI scan so we could look and quantify certain parts of the brain, specifically the hippocampus. And we have a really cool tool that we use in our center, which can automate that process. So usually when you do brain imaging, which I've known because I've spent most of my adult life hunched over a terminal looking at brain blobs. but there's a cool new tool now, which shows me that I've wasted all that time in my PhD, which actually automates the quantification of MRI. So what that does is basically gives you a percentile score of how big or small your hippocampus is relative to people of your same age, gender, and years of education. So it kind of gives you an idea of how much atrophy has happened within specifically the hippocampus in the brain and compares that against other people. And that helps our dementia neurologist make her diagnosis in terms of, you know, what might be happening in the brain. So is this something that is pathological, that needs to have more cognitive testing done to determine the kind of memory concerns that they have, how severe they are?
Is the shrinking of the hippocampus something that's happening because we are more sedentary and aren't getting physical activity? Or is this something that would happen in any circumstance?
It makes it a lot worse. It really accelerates the aging process. And there's actually been some studies done in exercise. So there was a study that was done that looked at people during their midlife years, so in their 40s, 50s, and 60s, and then tracked them into when they became older adults in their 80s and 90s. And what they found was that people that were more physically active, so actually doing more moderate to vigorous physical activity, they delayed the onset by about 20 years of Alzheimer's disease and the people that actually got it. And they actually had about a 70% less chance of getting Alzheimer's disease than the people that weren't really physically active in those midlife years. So it does seem that there's something really special about midlife physical activity and also reducing vascular risk factors, because we know that those vascular risk factors, you know, having diabetes, having heart conditions, things like that, also lead up to risk factors for developing Alzheimer's in later years. So It's never too late to get started. And a lot of research is saying that it is really critical during those midlife years to stay physically, not just physically active, but also cognitively active too, and constantly doing new activities. So I know you recently started drumming. So I think that you're on the right track here, and you're keeping that going, because it's not just about all the education you've had leading up to this moment. It's about continuing that and constantly building new neuronal networks and circuits and acquiring new skills throughout the lifespan, because exercise, physical exercise and cognitive exercise do very, very different things in the brain. So as I've described with exercise, that really builds up the neurogenesis and the blood flow and synaptogenesis and all of those things within kind of the neuronal health. But the interesting with cognitive training or cognitive stimulation or new skill learning, if you will, is that actually helps the newly grown neurons and the newly formed connections in the brain actually integrate into the system and not die off. So it's really important that not only you get exercise to build up these neurochemicals in the brain, but then you're also getting these cognitive challenges that stimulate those new neurons and make sure that they integrate into the system properly.
Okay. So now with the studies you're doing, you're trying to put the proof right here in the pudding, right?
Exactly.
Tell us about what you have going on.
Exactly. So one of the studies I want to tell you guys about today is our prevention trial, which, get ready for this super fun acronym. Prevention stands for Precision Recommendations for Environmental Variables, Exercise, Nutrition, and Training Interventions to Optimize Neurocognition. Prevention.
How long did that take to come up with?
That's what they pay me for around there, really. It's just to come up with the fun acronyms.
That's a brain challenge right there.
Yeah, just to remember that. Unfortunately, we know, for Alzheimer's disease, there's no cure. There's no pharmacological cure. There's no disease modifying therapy. I mean, there's some that are kind of on the horizon, but the reality is, it's like for the last 30, 40 years, they've all been targeting amyloid. And the problem is the clearance of amyloid doesn't actually do anything in real life. It's worked really well in animal models, but the problem is in humans, just wiping out the amyloid, they can still get Alzheimer's disease.
The amyloid, again, is this like kind of stuff that gums up the circuits?
Exactly. So yeah, there's beta amyloid that builds up in the brain, and there's also tau tangles. So one of them, it happens inside the neurons, and one of them happens between the neurons. So both of those things are implicated in the neuropathology of the development of Alzheimer's disease. But the reality is like, there's a lot more going on than just the buildup of beta amyloid and the neurofibrillary tau tangles. That's not the whole story. So now a lot of people are trying to kind of go back and think about the root causes of the disease and what's going on. Because usually what happens is that buildup happens over many, 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 many years. The prodromal before they actually get the disease is about 20 years long. So it's really long time that, things are kind of just going the wrong way in the brain. So essentially what we're trying to do in the prevention trial is course correct for that. So instead of people having this rapid decline in the years leading up to getting Alzheimer's disease, we want to try to fix that, if you will. And we really want to try to optimize a lot of different factors in the body, and that will affect the brain as well, too. The way that we're doing that is through a personalized and biologically data-driven intervention. And basically what that means is that it's not a one-size-fits-all intervention. This is very much personalized down to the individual. There's a lot of research showing that, we can give people specific diet interventions, like give them the mind diet, give them a certain exercise regime or a certain cognitive training protocol, and they get a little bit better, but it's not really striking. So what we're really trying to do in this study is collect a whole host of blood labs, brain imaging, physiological markers, microbiome, cortisol swabs, full genetic workups on these people, and find out really the whole picture about the individuals that are in the study. So it's a small study. We've only got 60 people in this study. And these individuals are all proven that they have probable Alzheimer's disease. And the way that we've done that is giving them the amyloid PET scan. So they actually already have enough buildup of amyloid in the brain to say that they're probably on track to get Alzheimer's. And that's one thing that's a prerequisite for being in this study. So they have to have that scan done.
And now a message from our sponsor. The Think Neuro podcast is brought to you by Pacific Neuroscience Institute Foundation, a nonprofit 501c3 organization. If you're inspired by what you hear and wish to support our mission of education through innovation, please visit pacificneuro.org/foundation. Are all 60 getting a personalized regimen?
So this is a randomized clinical trial. So really, that's exactly what we're trying to manipulate in the study. So, you know, we've all heard by our doctors and, you know, friends and TV and books and everything telling us, you know, all the things we should do. So basically, we're giving everybody in the study these precision clinical recommendations for diet, exercise, cognitive training. However, only half of the group is going to be given those interventions. So half of the group is given a health coach, which is basically shepherding them through the 12 months of the intervention, where they're actually handholding them to make sure that they're doing their dietary intervention, that they're meeting with the dietitian that we're giving them for the study. It's helping them optimize their different nutritional factors. We're trying to help work towards a ketogenic diet because we know that that really helps with brain health. We know
it increases. Describe that. The ketogenic is?
Ketogenic is where the brain starts to use fat as a energy source in the brain, which is shown to be more effective for brain functioning.
So and it also eating more what?
Fatty foods. It's a very, very low carb diet, very low sugar diet, lots of fats, healthy fats, a lot of plant-based protein as well too. And this is what we're trying to help work for, you know, get them to that place in the study. Not everybody wants to try to get into ketosis. We have keto meters that we give them to check their blood levels. But really we start at the phase where we're just really trying to get their glucose in check.
So we're trying to get ketosis is for those of us who are, who haven't done that.
It's basically where you can get your blood, to a state where you're getting your ketone levels high enough, where the brain and the body start to use fat as its primary energy source, as opposed to glucose.
Okay. Okay. So but you're not going for that here. You're just...
We're trying. I mean, we're nudging as much as we can, which is really the important thing with health coaching. I mean, when you're trying to optimize 100 different things in the body and, you know, lifestyle factors and kind of rapidly take over people's lives, you kind of have to do that in a really paced, methodical way. And that's really the purpose of the health coach. And the health coach we have for this study is fantastic because she has a background in data-driven health coaching, which means using people's biological data to help inform health coaching. And also really the idea that, you know, these are older adults that, you know, don't necessarily just want to, you know, throw everything out of the fridge tomorrow or start training for a marathon, you know, I want to do it in a very methodical way. So I think the idea with the study too, is that, you know, because we're at the Pacific Brain Health Center and all of these patients are coming from our clinic, that they're meeting regularly with a study physician as well too. That's really helping them understand what those blood measures mean. And then the health coach coming in to really help them optimize those things. And so in addition to having the health coach, we also have the CogFit program, which is our combined physical and cognitive training program that is done with our fitness trainer, Ryan Glatt, who I know you've had on the podcast before.
Yeah, great guy.
He's awesome. He's awesome. And he is really special because he has a background in neuroscience and really the application of trying to combine physical and cognitive training, specifically in older adults, he has experience. So we're really lucky to have him there. And he's running that intervention at the moment in the patient. So he's doing 2 times a week with them with the CogFit program. And then they also have cognitive training that they do as well. So we do a computer-based cognitive training program for them. And also a different kind of like supplement regime that they have too, to try to optimize different vitamin factors. And then we also look at things like toxicity, so heavy metal screening, and how we can try to remove those sorts of things from the system. So we're really trying to optimize, you know, kitchen sink approach here of everything that we can in the body and in the brain to try to help cognitive functioning. And the end point and the hopefully goal of this study, the major outcome that we're looking at is an improvement in cognitive functioning. So all of the that are in the prevention trial are actually individuals that have been diagnosed with MCI, which is mild cognitive impairment. And that's really the phase of the illness before people get Alzheimer's disease. So it's kind of right around that transition time. So it's a really important time to try to intervene and try to course correct for these individuals. So this is really interesting because there has been some lifestyle modification studies. One of the most well-known is the finger trial, which is this Finnish geriatric study where they did lifestyle modification over 2 years with many different factors, with modified diet, physical training, cognitive training. But these were all individuals that were just healthy older adults that didn't have any cognitive impairments. But they showed after 2 years, this was a 2-year intervention they did, the individuals that were randomized to the active intervention compared to people that were just giving recommendations improved their cognitive functioning. But for the first time, we're the first study that's actually going to look at people that have the earliest stages of Alzheimer's disease and also intervening with a precision approach where it's not just a one size fits all sort of a diet recommendation or exercise prescription, but it's very much specific to the individual. So there's a lot of reasons this study is going to stand out in terms of the impact it's going to have on the field with regards to, number one, trying to personalize these interventions down to the individual. And number two, having it done in a population that actually already has memory impairments. And if we're able to repair those circuits that seem to be disrupted already. So the primary outcome that we're looking at 12-month follow-up is cognitive functioning. And then we're also looking at the hippocampus. So we're looking at that hippocampal atrophy we're talking about, if we're actually able to reverse that in the individuals that were in the active arm of the intervention.
Okay, so what's the control group in this?
The control group is getting the same recommendations, so the same personalized recommendations that are given to them by their study physician. So ways to optimize their diet, ways to do different kinds of physical activities, cognitive training. But the difference is they're just given those recommendations. In the active arm of the study, we're actually giving them a health coach that's going to handhold them through the entire 12 months of the study. And we're also giving them the intervention. So we're giving them the cognitive training and exercise program, which is known as the FitBrain program that we have at the Pacific Brain Health Center. They're getting a specific dietary coach that they meet with several times over the 12 months of the study, that they're doing one-on-one Zoom counseling with them of trying to optimize different factors in the blood and different vitamin levels and what they're eating every day, and really trying to promote ketosis, which ketosis we know is really important in brain health, and something they've looked at in animals a lot, where they're actually able to show that animals that are on a very, very low carbohydrate diet, actually, instead of using carbohydrates as the primary energy source in the brain, they start using fat. So they're actually using fat as the primary energy source, and something called ketones, which are actually important for trying to improve the functioning of the brain. So they've used this a lot in other models with epilepsy before. So it's really the first time we're trying to have it done in a memory impairment population of trying to get them into the ketogenic state. And we're measuring their blood levels and ketone levels throughout the study as well too. Obviously that's ideally where we would like to get with the patients. But everybody's different. Not everybody wants to have a total upheaval of their, you know, diet and lifestyle all at once. So we're making sure that we're slowly scaffolding and introducing and making sure what the patients are comfortable with too. So one of the cool things we can look at in the study is the dose response. So there's going to be kind of a natural biases in the sample where a lot of people are going to be all about it and do everything we recommend. And then some of the people that might be a little wishy-washy or might not adhere to the intervention. So in a statistical analysis, we could look at the adherence rates. Because one of the most interesting things in lifestyle research, be it exercise or cognitive training, is it's really the dosage, really that dosage regime that's really specific to the individual. So some people may need to do, you know, really extensive lifestyle changes, and some people maybe not that much. And it really depends on the individual starting point. So maybe where their insulin levels are starting, or, you know, for the exercise program, where their lactate threshold is, certain things that we know can be modified through different sort of dosage regimes that are specific to the individual. So these are the kinds of questions we have that we're going to be able to look at in this study.
Did you consider having a group that got no intervention, or would that just have been like cruel?
Well, so here's the thing about being a scientist working in a clinic is that the clinicians want to give their patients the best. That's obviously what they want to do at the Brain Health Center. So trying to conduct a clinical trial where we have a group that's not getting anything, they don't really want to sign their patients up for that, because we know that this works. You know, there's buckets and years of empirical data to suggest we should be doing these kinds of interventions. So really kind of where we're dedicating the effort and allocation of funds into the study, though, is the active intervention. But of course, the people that are in the control arm, if you will, are still getting all these amazing, you know, blood workups and PET scans and MRIs and all of those great recommendations and meetings with the study physician, as they would if they were a patient at the Brain Health Center, but we're not actually providing them with the interventions themselves or the health coach.
And when will you have the data?
So we actually had our first patient complete this month. So we started enrolling patients in this study in September of 2019. So people are starting to come up on that 1 year follow-up, but we'll be collecting data for probably the next 2 years. And then we should have data coming after that.
And what's your suspicion, if you had to guess? I mean, you have some ideas, I'm sure.
Well, I mean, clearly, you know, it's hard to adopt all of these lifestyle changes. So I think one of the really clear things coming from a psychology background in behavior change is that it takes a really special intervention to be able to change all these factors in people. So I think really the secret sauce we're going to find is that those in the health coached arm of the intervention are going to have much better outcomes and much better adherence to the recommendations that we're giving them. And additionally, I think too, one thing that I haven't talked about is that one of the objectives of the study is that, I mean, we're collecting so much data on these people. I mean, probably more than any study I've ever read before in terms of clinical labs that we're getting from them, you know, so metabolic panels. We're also getting cytokine levels. We're getting blood markers of infections. I mean,
Describe cytokines.
So cytokines are measures of inflammation in the blood that we can look at. So there's pro-inflammatory cytokines and anti-inflammatory cytokines. So we want to look at both kinds of those. So we want to be measuring for things that might be playing into that bigger picture of the root cause of what's causing the memory concerns and what's causing the atrophy in the brain, since we can't point it to one thing.
How much is inflammation a factor in all of this?
Massive. I mean, that's really where all of the new theories and where they're putting in a lot of effort into the new disease modifying therapies from a pharmacological standpoint is they think it's a little too late when you start treating the beta amyloid and trying to knock that out. It's usually too late in the disease process. So you kind of want to take a step back. And what they're finding is the neuroinflammation is actually happening as one of the earliest markers. So there's something called neurofilament light chain, which is a new blood-based biomarker, which could be a really cool, easy to get biomarker in the blood. It's not specific to Alzheimer's disease, but it's an early indication that there's some sort of neurodegeneration going on in the brain. So that is one of the factors we're starting to look at, and it's linked to having chronic levels of systemic inflammation.
Wait, I'm sorry. So a high level of that indicator is a bad thing?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
It means there's more more neurodegeneration in the brain. And they usually think that the neurodegeneration and that marker is able to pick it up about 15 years before the incipient onset of an Alzheimer's diagnosis. So it's something that if you can catch it early enough, then you could try to, you know, really build in these lifestyle factors and habits and optimizing of all, you know, your bloods and your vitamin levels, removing toxins from yourself and your environment, all these different things that you could try to optimize so you don't have the buildup of the beta amyloid and the tau tangles in your
skin. Sure. I mean, what I've read is that we live sort of an inflammatory lifestyle with lots of carbohydrates, white carbohydrates, sugars. Those are inflammatory, aren't they?
Big time. Yeah. So yeah, that's a big reason for, you know, it's not just diet. It's not just exercise. It's not just cognitive stimulation. You know, it's all of these factors coming together. I mean, they've shown that modifiable risk factors, which are things that you're talking about, things that we can change in our environment. Then there's non-modifiable risk factors, like your genetics, you know, your age. But what they found is with lifestyle changes, you can actually, you know, go to bat against those negative factors that you have in your life. So if you have something like APOE4, which is what we know the largest genetic risk for Alzheimer's disease, if you started implementing all these lifestyle factors, you can actually, you know, maybe do better than people that didn't have that genetic risk factor for the illness, because you so aggressively went at it and tried to fight off these different inflammatory processes, toxins, and other things that are negatively affecting your brain health.
What do you do anything with smoking or alcohol in these, in the study and in the interventions?
Absolutely. So those are huge, huge risk factors.
Yeah.
So it was actually the Lancet Commission that came out with a paper a couple of months ago that was showing that there's about 10 factors that are the biggest risk factors, modifiable risk factors for developing dementia. And definitely smoking and alcoholism were in there.
Alcohol, or alcoholism, like how much, like there was a study out recently about this, but like how much is safe? I mean, smoking's definitely bad, but with alcohol, is any amount safe when it comes to dementia?
Well, there's different camps, right? So you try to look at like the Mediterranean diet, right? And they say, oh, a glass of wine a day, no big thing, you know? But then you listen to other camps that are like, well, more than 4 units a week actually has a toxic effect on hippocampal volume and hippocampal atrophy. And some studies that were done in a British cohort a few years ago. So, you know, I feel like the jury's out with that. I mean, and also too, you got to look from a genetic standpoint, you know, there's different people that have a predisposition for alcoholism, and, you know, you kind of want to try to not promote that for people, even though there's some good benefits in terms of, you know, different antioxidants that you can get from red wine, you know. But at the same time, it's all about moderation, you know, and you kind of have to play up to the fact that, you know, everybody has different kind of, you know, social activities that they do and ways that they relax, you know. So I think you kind of all have to take it in stride and make sure that, you know, you're not trying to promote people having these negative lifestyle behaviors, but, you know, also being real to the situation and, you know, how certain things people do in their lives. You know, it doesn't have to be catastrophic as long as they can keep it in a moderate level.
Sure. Now, okay, so that's one study. You have another one going?
Yes. So we also have the MSIM study, which is our simultaneous memory and cognitive training study. So this was the next logical step after the study that Dr. Merrill and I did at UCLA, where we were in the clinic with patients that had memory impairments. Now what I wanted to do was develop a home-based version of that. So anybody can have access to being able to do simultaneous exercise and cognitive training within their own homes. So this particular study is funded by the National Institute of Aging at the NIH. And just to kind of take a step back, you know, in the original study at UCLA, what we wanted to do was show those synergistic benefits, which I described, of how we had people doing recumbent cycling, doing the compensatory memory training, and finding after 4 weeks, they had greater improvements in their memory functioning. So in this study, what we were trying to do was replicate that. And since we found that the simultaneous exercise was more advantageous for memory functioning, that's really the design. So the active group in the study is getting the simultaneous exercise intervention. And then the control group in the study were just monitoring their physical activity levels with a Fitbit.
Okay.
And the patients that are in this study are patients with amnestic MCI, which means that they have mild cognitive impairment, but their primary cognitive concern is with memory, and it's severely impaired. So these are really the people we want to give those tools to, try to give them the strategies to help with the compensatory strategies to be able to get through their daily lives. But part of the cool thing about this study too is that it's not just about giving them these tools. We're also trying to scaffold other parts of cognitive functioning. So just giving people memory strategies isn't enough. We also need to give them other kinds of skills that's going to help them get through their daily lives. So some of the things that we're doing are based on like goal-directed attentional training, which is a special kind of attention and like mindfulness-based meditation and metacognitive strategies, to try to help them with something we call stop, relax, and refocus, which is when you have your mind wandering. So the interesting thing about memory is that it's not just that you have a bad ability to remember things, it's that you weren't paying attention in the first place most of the time. You're so actively distracted. And there's two different kinds of things happening. So there's dual tasking, which is actually a pro-cognitive behavior, which is something that was based out of neuropsychology, which is when you're specifically having somebody do two things at the same time, exactly what we're doing in the intervention, aerobic cycling, which is, you know, it's automatic. You don't really have to think about it that much. And then you have the cognitive demands, but there's something that's bad for the brain, which is doing multitasking, which is when you're trying to do too many things at the same time, which is when you're, you know, talking to your kids, but you're on a Zoom call and you're, you know, looking at your emails and you're on your Slack and you're all over the place with all of these distractions. How are you ever going to remember anything?
No, you're not even there in the beginning. No.
So that's exactly where we start from in this program. And then we build from there. So we build in mindfulness meditation and these sort of attentional strategies to help people learn how to stay in the moment, because that's what's going to help with their memory. And then we also give them a lot of psychoeducation too. So I think a big part of, you know, memory and aging is a lot of people don't realize so much of it is normal, you know, because of the aging processes that happen. And so much we know things do decline as we age, but then there's other things that aren't part of the normal aging process, you know, and we really just want to highlight for the patients, you know, what might be going on in their brains. And then that motivates them further to engage in the program. Yeah. And then we also give them organizational skills too. So we have this thing called like a stuff station, is where they put all their stuff when they walk in the house so they don't lose their keys.
I have one of those.
I think it's great. I have one.
I have a shelf.
You have a stuff.
Everything
shelf.
Goes right on the shelf. Yep.
Perfect.
Are those people? What are they doing in terms of the simultaneous brain and body exercise? Are they like doing a Sudoku puzzle on an exercise bike? What's that component look like?
No, they're actually doing the memory training. So the cool thing about this study and the way that we've designed it is that it's all home-based. So everybody in the study that's in the active arm gets an exercise bike that has a desk on it. And then we give them a tablet so they can put the tablet on the desk. So it's kind of a reverse engineered Peloton, I guess, if you will, but much cheaper, much, much cheaper. and actually the content is not some sweaty trainer, it's actually a learning management system that they're engaging with to learn this memory curriculum. So this is something Dr. Jennifer Brayman and I have been developing, she is our senior program manager for clinical research and a neuroscientist. Her and I have been developing the curriculum along with Arthi, who is our memory trainer as well at the Brain Health Center. So we've been developing all of this curriculum that allows the learner to be able to engage with the program in a fun way. So we do a lot of role playing and, you know, listening to, you know, a voicemail from your daughter, and she's telling you about a recent trip she had to Yosemite. And we give them the active listening skills where they have different things they're supposed to do during that activity, basically simulating a real life situation to help them remember it better.
While they're on the exercise bike.
While they're on the bike. So
the
cool thing about the research with the temporal ordering of exercise is that you want to make sure that you're not overloading the physiological and cognitive system. So there's kind of this trade-off that happens when the exercise is too hard, you can't think straight. But if the exercise is too easy, then you're not actually getting into the place where your brain is releasing all those chemicals and you're hitting that threshold for brain plasticity. So we get people in a moderate aerobic zone. So they're about 60 to 80% of their max heart rate. And we have the bike calibrated, so they need to be hitting a certain RPM speed and keeping that up throughout the exercise. They have a Fitbit that's tracking their heart rate, so they make sure that they're staying active that whole time. And once they get into that place, that's when we then have them learn the new strategy. So they actually have the tablet in front of them. They're, you know, going through the program. They're answering the quizzes. They're listening to our little avatars talking. They're going through all the different vignettes and activities. And they do this for 12 weeks. And then after the 12 weeks, we test them on their cognitive functioning.
So what are the biomarkers that you're going to be looking at to gauge the success of this?
Right. So in addition to looking at the cognitive functioning at the end of the intervention, we're also interested in looking at two biological markers. So one of them being brain-derived neurotrophic factor, which we know is one of the richest trophic factors in the brain to help with support neuronal functioning and brain health. So we're going to be measuring that pre and post study to see if that increases within the blood. We know the highest density of BDNF is found in the hippocampus. So we're hoping what's happening is that BDNF is increasing within the blood, is increasing centrally within the hippocampus as well too. And that's promoting the neurogenesis, neuroplasticity, and cell survival. And the other thing that we're interested in looking at is norepinephrine. So the reason that we're looking at norepinephrine is because it's released by the locus coeruleus during physical activity. And this also facilitates learning and memory as well too. So the locus coeruleus is the main source of norepinephrine during physical activity, and it activates the reticular activating system, which increases arousal levels. So this is the reason that when you're doing physical aerobics in a state that's not too intense, your brain is actually primed and activated for taking on new information. So this is really a state-dependent learning phase, if you will, where you've optimized the brain for a place for learning and memory. And part of that, we think, is due to the increase of norepinephrine levels. And one other thing, too, is that we know that the loss of neurons within the locus coeruleus, that part of the brain that releases the norepinephrine, is reduced in those with AD neuropathology. So the reduced concentrations of norepinephrine are believed to be happening early in the course of the disease. So we're hoping we can increase that within these early memory impairment patients. And the last thing that we're looking at too is quantitative EEG. So this is basically where they put this, it looks like a swim cap with electrodes on it, and you're measuring electrical activity in the brain, and it's totally non-invasive. And it's a method of recording EEG data. And you can do it in a clinical setting. So this is something they use at the Brain Health Center every day to try to look at brain activity in a non-invasive way. It takes about an hour to do. And you can get an idea about the rhythms and the electrical functioning within the brain using this system. And what we're interested in this particular study is looking at peak alpha, which the alpha rhythm, which is about 8 to 12 hertz, is originally identified in the resting state brain. So it's kind of a resting state rhythm. And it's important for something known as inhibitory tone. So higher alpha power means that the brain systems are being inhibited, whereas low alpha power means the brain is experiencing less inhibition, allowing for the engagement of more active states. So alpha really plays a critical role in the timing of neurological and cognitive processes like working memory, attention, anticipation. And these are all things we know that slow with aging and neuropathology. So looking at peak alpha frequency, which slows with age, and is correlated with cognitive decline, is something that we're interested in looking at in this study as well, too.
I can't help but think that all of this, it gets back to how we used to live when we were hunter-gatherers and we're running around chasing food, and that involved learning and increasing our cognition about how these things work and how animals behave and how plants behave. And now we just don't do that. I mean, maybe that's too simplistic, but.
Well, I mean, how do you manufacture that in a clinical setting, right? And how do we do that in clinical trials? So that's exactly what we're trying to do in our studies. And it's all about lifestyle. I mean, all of these are lifestyle interventions that we're doing at the Brain Health Center. So these are all things that have to do with, sleep is a huge topic as well, too. So, I mean, we could do a whole nother podcast about
It only took me about, I don't know, 4 decades to figure out, maybe 5, all my life, to figure out that you really need to prioritize sleep and exercise.
You do.
And exercise I had a clue about, but sleep, oh boy.
Yeah, I mean, you hear like these, silly anecdotes, I'll sleep when I'm dead, and I would just want to be productive. I only need 3-4 hours. Well, you don't. Mm-mm. There's nobody that lives like that. I'm sorry. You can tell yourself whatever you want to be productive, but the The reality is we all need a solid 7, 8, 9 hours every single night. It's critical for your brain health. It clears that disgusting beta amyloid from the CSF. It helps with memory consolidation. I mean, there's massive, massive amounts of research to show that we really, really need our sleep. And the good thing about exercise is it's going to help you sleep better too.
Exactly. All right. So that's our next topic. But this is great. I'm going to go back and hit the treadmill. We have a Peloton in the house, thank God now.
when we have our cognitive training program ready too, you can put that on your tablet as well.
And excellent.
That's one of the things at the Brain Health Center too is, you know, we're really excited about developing evidence-based interventions for improving cognitive functioning that are scalable, you know, stuff that you can do anywhere at home. That's really the idea. And that's really what brought us to the Pacific Neuroscience Institute, was that we just didn't want to be doing our research, and putting out papers nobody ever reads, but we want to be creating interventions that are salient for patients that really, really need them, and how we can get them to those people in an expeditious way, how we could look at outcomes that are evidence-based in those individuals, and how we could really move the needle on clinical care and evidence-based research.
Well, I got to tell you, with you and Ryan Glad on the job, people are going to get healthy. I guarantee it.
Well, we practice what we preach, you know? Yeah. So yeah, me too. I do my cognitive training exercise every day. You know, I listen to my podcast on my runs, you know, I keep myself, I like you took up drumming in my older years as well. So I'm trying to keep learning new skills and
you're probably much better than I am.
I mean, that's the beauty of all of this stuff, though, is like, yeah, there is no better. There's what's better for you, you know? So that's really the main thing you need to keep in mind. And don't try to chase somebody else's ambitions, but just try to optimize yourself, you know? And also, too, like working hand in hand with your clinicians and making sure that you're, you know, doing the deep dive on your biology. And you're not just taking supplements because they're the flavor of the week, you know, but that you actually really need to optimize these things. And yeah, stay away from the snake oils. You know, there's no FDA approved supplements for cognition right now. Spoiler alert, sorry.
Spoiler alert, right.
There's not, and there's no disease modifying therapies for individuals with MCI or Alzheimer's, you know. So the best tools we have in our toolbox right now are exercise and cognitive stimulation and these lifestyle interventions. So hopefully, you know, with the work that we're doing in these clinical trials, we're gonna be able to look at more of those biological factors. And a lot of the work that we're doing with the Institute for Systems Biology up in Seattle, headed by Dr. Leroy Hood there, is really looking at these dense data clouds on the individuals that are in the prevention study. So then we could start to look at those individual factors that are contributing to either a treatment response or not response to the intervention on many, many, many thousands of different microbiome, proteomics, metabolomic levels that we wouldn't be able to look at with a simple blood test, you know. We really need to take those deep dives so we can look at, you know, is it really the inflammation? Is it really, you know, toxicity of, you know, different environmental factors and finding out, you know, what is it in the individual that was disrupted that we were able to fix that actually made the big difference in cognitive functioning and brain plasticity.
Yeah.
So that's going to be some really exciting data. I think that's going to be.
Well, let's get together again and talk about that.
I'd love to.
Well, this has been delightful. Dr. McEwen, thank you a ton for your time. It's I've learned a lot, and I think our listeners will too.
It was my pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you.